via Skype, and also those who are connected by via Facebook streaming. The astral body, physical body, which comprises of the body that we see and the subtle one, the mind that we do not see. The physical body dissolves. The astral body moves from womb to womb and from grave to grave. You have to understand that witness is pure consciousness. It remains unaffected by body and the mind. However, it takes temporary residence in as well. So first you have to understand how do personality traits and conditioning persist from one life to another. And secondly, you have to understand that which makes us unique individual have a continuum. Therefore, the first you have to understand that you do not have this body of flesh and bones and blood. Not only this brain, which is part of the body. Behind the brain, you have a mind which is abstract. Not only that, behind the body, you have an astral body as well. The word astral comes from stars. It means a light. Instead of flesh and bone, astral body is made of light. This body of light, the astral body, has a mind in it. When you die, physical body and physical mind are left behind. But the astral body travels with you, with the mind, with all the remembrance of the past life and the body, remembering all the scars and wounds that have happened to the physical body. This abstract phenomenon travels with you, and hiding within it is your ultimate existential center. Until you know this center, you will have to travel continuously from body to body, from one body to another. And knowing this center is being connected to it. You have been traveling already for thousands of lives, gathering more and more memories in your astral mind. More and more memories in your astral mind. Although your center remains unaffected, it is surrounded by the astral body, and the astral body goes on moving from womb to womb, from grave to grave. And that is your individuality. It is a continuum. But the continuum comes to an end, when you attain to awakening, you begin to live in your center. You become a Buddha. You become awakened one, the enlightened one. When you penetrate deeply to the center, you are also cutting the astral body apart and then making a way through the mind, yet beyond the mind, through the astral body, and beyond the astral body to the center of your being. The physical body, the astral body, the physical mind, the astral mind. And you reach to the center of your being. Once you have discovered the center of your being, the continuum of your individuality stops. The river that has been traveling all through the plains have now reached the shore, the ocean. It has an individuality. Drop by drop, it begins to merge into the ocean. The continuum of of the individuality of the river comes to cessation. Now begins the universal existence. The drop is no more recognized as a drop belonging to that particular river. This is the individuality. This individuality is lost. You will not be entering into another womb. You will not be burnt on another funeral pyre again. Now you will be one with the whole, the existence. Of course, everything has a cost. You will have to drop your long cherished love of individuality. Millions of years you have loved your individuality. All through the travel from its source in the mountains, the river continues to flow through various ebbs, through various stages of turbulence. Sometimes it deviated from its path, got wavered, and then returns back on the track. Sometimes gets flooded, other times it becomes dry. All these things happen along the path the river travels from its origin to the destiny, the final. For all these long journey, the drop maintains its unique individuality and it loves it. But your individuality at the final stage becomes a hindrance. Now time has come to take a quantum leap. It's not that you have to become oceanic in bits and pieces, in strokes, like a painter takes the brush and he puts a stroke here and a stroke there. It takes a while and then the whole image is colored. Take a jump out of the continuum that continuum, that flow that you had been, the drop has been flowing through the river. From there it takes a jump and becomes one with the whole. You will disappear just like a dewdrop in the ocean. The drop slips from the lotus leaf into the lake and vanishes. In a way it vanishes, but in another way it is resurrected. But it is the ultimate bliss. It is the most profound ecstasy to become the oceanic, to become the cosmic. You will never repent that you have lost your individuality. At times there come some moments in the life of the poets, in the life of the writers, in the life of musicians, when they are touched by that cosmic presence. Things flow through them without any restrictions. Otherwise, you have to make an effort to make a sentence. Words are not flowing, sentences are not forming, either the verb is wrong or the adjective or the flow is not there. But sometimes when you are touched by those moments, things happen spontaneously. You will never repent that you have lost your individuality, but something that you have not known, what happens when the drop expands beyond its horizon to become oceanic, what happens? It's a great risk. Until you become one, you will not know. What was in your individuality? Have you ever thought? Your individuality was like a light prism. A prism that you had carried from womb to womb, passing through the graves, one grave to the womb, and then womb to grave, this process continued, repeating the same process again and again. That is why in the East they call it the life and death cycle. It continues. You had been a part of it. It was embedded in you. To jump out of this cycle of birth and death is the whole purpose of meditation, is the whole purpose of the spiritual journey, and to come out of this continuum, which has been just cause of deep anguish, anxiety and fear, and to disappear into the blue sky. This process of disappearance into the unknown and unknowable, the cosmic womb, the sky, is not your death. The disappearance makes you one with the whole, and to be one with the whole is the greatest joy, the greatest blissfulness. Nothing is more significant, full of splendor and more majestic. Here all bubbles have disappeared in the ultimate eternity of existence. It is freedom from individuality, freedom from yourself. All the burdens, anxiety, of being an individual is no more. You have known freedom from others, but you do not recognize that you are still slave to your own individuality. It is a cage. It does not matter. It may be golden, it may be silver. Open the cage and fly across the sun into the blue sky and disappear. And then you do not leave any footprints or any trace behind. Gautam called this as anatta, non-soul, no self, no mind, no you, and no I. Lalaji Razi Allah Ta'ala Unho, the Naqshbandi Sheikh Ramchandra, used to say, doing the work of the masters, dissolve in the existence, leaving no footprints, as if no one with such a name has ever existed. This in fact can be said in another way. I have told you many times about Kabir and his son Kamal. Somehow Kabir has named him Kamal. Kamal means wonder, something, a wow factor. When he was young, he became enlightened and he wrote a small poem, a couplet, in which a line comes, "The drop has disappeared in the ocean." The composition goes on like that, like this. Herat herat he sakhi, raha Kabir herai. Herat means to watch. Herat herat he sakhi, sakhi means friend. Raha Kabir Harai. Harai means wonder is stuck, like a dism. Watching and watching, Kabir is stuck with wonder. But why is he and what is he watching? And why is he stuck with wonder? He is watching the drop, the river, disappearing into the ocean, drop by drop. He saw a drop disappearing. Oh, wonder. Then he saw another drop, and this process continues. Herat herat he sakhi, oh friend. Kabir wrote all his compositions in this format. These are known as Sakhi. Herat herat he sakhi. He did not say that watching and watching I have stuck with wonder. Herat herat he sakhi, raha Kabir herai. Kabir is stuck with wonder. He makes a change and uses the third person instead of the first person or the second person. Then he wrote it in the notebook. Not he wrote. Kabir was illiterate. He will call his son or any of his disciples and let them write. Long before this app of dictation was introduced by the laptops and the smartphones, Kabir used it. He will dictate it and his disciples or Kamal will write it out. The drop has disappeared in the ocean. When he was dying, he called his son and asked him to bring that notebook where that couplet was written. And he said to change that line now. It is so beautiful. The second composition is, the drop has disappeared in the ocean. Why are you changing it? Kamal inquired. And what is the substitute? Kamal said, when you had written that, I knew that something is missing. You have not completed the entire message. Kabir said, these are the moments of my last breath. There is no need to argue. Simply do what I am saying before this breath vanishes. You write instead. And what he called, what he wrote, Herath, Herath, He Sakhi. The lines, the first line is the same. Herath, Herath, He Sakhi, Raha Kabir Rai. Oh dear friend, Kabir is watching and continuously watching moment to moment, and in that he is stuck with wonder, like a deja vu, something that you cannot explain, something that has a wow factor. And the second, and the line that he introduced now, Samunda Samana Bundma, ocean has disappeared, has dissolved, has vanished in the drop. Sufis use this analogy to explain the state of enlightenment, the two shores of enlightenment. Because remember, river flows between the two shores. The two shores, and in between the space forms the bed, the river bed, where the water flows continuously, and that flow is known as the river. The two banks are necessary. They give a form and a shape to the river. The first stage, Sufis call it as fana, when the drop merges in the ocean. The second, why it is the second happens? So far you have lived your life in a particular way as an individual, guided by ego, ignorance, vanity and pride. Someone says something to you, you get hurt, you feel embarrassed. Because you consider yourself as an island, when you are part of the end, so in this you realize that you are part of the whole existence. It's like two people sitting on a couch, husband and wife, engaged in a brawl, an argument. One of them touches the other, and the person pulls out the part saying that, don't touch me. You see only your individuality, the body. So do not touch the body. But remember, both of you are sitting on the same couch. So the base on which you are sitting, both of you are sitting, is the same. it is touching you. And remember that the couch that you are sitting is one piece. It is a long piece of wood covered with a sponge, and the fabric, which is one piece. And it is resting on the same ground. The 2 feet may be apart from one another, but they are connected with the part, so that it another part, so that it becomes a frame and it can stay. You are in a closed room where you are exhaling, you are breathing. Without that, you will not be alive. Your spouse is also breathing. Both of you are breathing, and yet still you realize that you are separate from the other. So in the stage of fana, this is the state of dissolution. Your individuality vanishes, and with that the ego and ignorance too vanishes. You realize I am the part of this ocean. I am not separate from you. My physical body may not be touching you, but through the astral body, through the breathing, I am breathing you, you are breathing me. So when we are breathing the same air, there is something of you every moment is entering into me. Something of me is entering into you every moment. You are sitting on the same base. You may be using a different seat. You are traveling in a plane. You are sitting on a different seat, maybe in another corner of the plane. But you remember it is one body that is traveling. The destiny of each one of us is connected with one another. If anything happens to the plane, it will affect every one of you, whether you know the other or not. Whether you are in the front seat or the back or in the middle, whether you are in the cockpit or wherever you are, anything happens to that vehicle, it will affect each one of the passengers in the plane. This is an understanding. This is the first thing that happens. Because up to now you have lived an individual life. Now you realize something else happens, a greater realization comes in. It takes a little while for you to adjust to that. It takes a while for you to adjust to that. The old habits keeps on coming again and again. We become spiritual when we go to the temple and the churches, and when we have our religious scriptures in our hands. But when it comes to walking on the street, oh, you are walking and somebody by mistake hits you, all your spirituality have vanished, because that was fake, that was not a realization from within. And that realization that you are part of the cosmos is fana, the first stage. So this has to come first, that you have to realize that you are part of that. And when you have understood and it has become part of your total understanding, then what happens? You start reliving that moment, reliving that understanding. You start living that understanding. So far, you go on saying that this is my money, this is my car, this is my, all that goes on. Then you realize that it is no more. At such moments, one of the statement of mother from Aurobindo Ashram says, all money belongs to the mother. Everything belongs to the existence. All your thoughts, the money, the resources, because of certain mechanism, it has come to you. You are the custodian of it. The moment you start sharing it, you have awakening, you have understanding, you are sharing it. And whatsoever you have, you start sharing it and you will realize that it grows multifold. You are not miser in sharing what you have. Sometimes we feel that you have only a certain amount of money in your wallet. If you use it, it will finish. But once you are connected to a cosmic source, you will realize that the resources flow from in such a mysterious way that you cannot understand it. The moment you are connected to such a presence, you will find the life moves in such a simple and easy way that you do not know where the next breath comes from, but it comes. There is an assurance, and you continue to live like that. Then the second thing comes. What are the qualities of the ocean? It has the capacity to absorb everything that comes to it. It never says no to any river. It never says no to any drop. But you as an individual, you cannot allow this to enter your house and that to enter your house. And you go on claiming that you meditate very hard. Every day you meditate, you know the whole scriptures, Surah Fatiha, Hanuman Chalisa, or the Psalms from Bible. You know all that and you chant these every morning. What is the use of this if it has not become part of your understanding? You start sharing. This is the quality of the ocean. The magnanimity has become your part. Now, out of ignorance, and that is a part of the Western world, the intellectual copyright, something that has come through you. But where has it come from? Was it yours? Simply because it has come out of your pen does not mean it is yours. A similar thought can happen to someone else at the same moment. Because when light comes, sun rises in the morning, you have a garden. Garden have different flowers. The light falls on each flower bud. And each bud starts singing, each bird starts singing, the bud starts opening. The final presence is different. The bud may say that I am the bud, I am the rose. One bird sings in one way and another sings in another way. But all of them are incandescent with one source, which is sun, sunlight. If the sunlight decides that it is not falling on a rose bud in this particular corner, it cannot blossom, but sun cannot see that. I am shining. It is up to you to be open to me, to be vulnerable to me. Now each drop becomes vulnerable to that presence. Yes, something has happened through me. This is what the entire message of Jalaluddin Rumi is. You become so empty within. There is no inertia. If there is something residue within the bottle, whatsoever you add will get contaminated. So the bottle is clean inside and empty. So this is what he calls the hollow bamboo. In the process of drop merging into the ocean, it becomes hollow within. All that has been, it was filled in with, is no more there. That garbage, that ignorance, that vanity, that fake pride has vanished. It has become hollow inside. How can you become hollow? Is there the, when I take a piece of bamboo, it has pieces of unwanted wood. So it is through a process, all that is removed and it becomes a thin wall of the bamboo. It has become hollow and homogeneous like a cylinder. So can we take a drill and then they drill it to you, through you? You can do it through the piece of bamboo to remove all the knots. Because you remember the bamboo is separated by knots. Each knot connects to the other portion. Inside, the residue of those knots is there. In the same way, it is there in an individual. A knot of ego is there, it has its residue within. Outside, it may look. When you look at the knots in a piece of bamboo, outside it may look smooth, the outer surface. But when you peep within, certain portions of the knot are bulging out, making the passage narrow. And then when the knot is crossed over, the passage becomes wide. So it's not a homogeneous passage. So something or the drill is taken and it makes the inner passage homogeneous. Something like this cannot be done to an individual, but through your awareness, through your understanding, through the stage of fana, this happens. When this happens, now earlier on when the air was being blown, it does not flow and the sound is not homogeneous. It gets blocked somewhere or the other. So the state of baka, the second stage, the second shore, the ocean has become part of the drop, means the totality has lent its quality to the drop. Now you are talking in a cosmic sense. You are no more like an individual. As an individual parent, you have certain responsibilities. But the existence has given you resources which you are using for the purpose of the existence. What am I doing? Sharing my presence. And this presence is overflowing in the form of words, in the form of messages. If any of these single line, a message, becomes a part of you, your life will begin to move in a totally different direction. But you have to allow this seed-like message to grow into your fertile soil. But that part you have to do. Sometimes the presence prepares the soil. It works in a multifarious way. It prepares the soil. It provides you the seed. It plants the seed in you. And it nourishes and nurtures the seed. Whenever you are faltering, you are deviating from the path. It pulls you. It pulls you in a loving way. And so that your journey continues. Then you start acting in the same way. Many times I have mentioned of this particular line from Mirza Ghalib. Aate hain ye mazameer khayal mein ghaib se. Ghalib nawae sharoz sharir khama hai. Aate hain ye mazameer, mazameer means thoughts. Khayal mein into my empty space of the mind. Thought is something that coming, but where it is coming like a guest into the inner space. Khayal mein ghaib se. Ghaib means that realm, that cosmic realm where everything exists. From there it comes. When you blow the air into the hollow bamboo, music flows. You are blowing the air. What are you doing? You are blowing the air into the small hole of, in the reed, in the flute. The inner space of the flute provides an space to create a sound. Then there are notes, there are holes. By manipulating those holes onto the surface of the flute, by adjusting the space, you become versatile in doing that. But it is the sound, it is the energy that is coming from the cosmic source. So it is not mine. Mere dil ko dil na samjho, meri jaan ko jaan na samjho. Koi aur bolta hai meri zubaan na samjho. Do not consider my heart to be mine. Mere dil ko dil na samjho. Do not consider my heart to be mine. Do not consider my being to be mine. Someone else speaks through me. Someone else speaks through me. You can take a million examples to explain that. The electricity comes from the outside source. Bulb has capacity to absorb, to manifest its qualities. Your electric stove has the capacity to, has the quality to manifest. It has been designed like that. You have been with this process of dissolution. You have been designed to manifest a certain quality of the existence. Existence is the richest source of everything that happens. The traits of painting, the traits of physics, the mathematics, the chemistry, the poetry, everything is there in it. The moment you are trained in a particular way, the same thing starts manifesting through you. Your physical body is made of a green texture. When a light passes through you, through the bulb, the green colored light is manifested. You are trained in a particular way. When that light passes through you, so you deep down, do you understand? You understand that it is Ghalib Sharire Khama Navai Sharu Ghalib Navai Sharire Khama. The sound that you are hearing, Sharire Khama, Sharir means the sound. Just that sound that you are hearing is that of an angel that is speaking through me. When you really look into, when you are writing something or when you are composing a poetry, it is a something like a small voice comes to you. You hear that voice, and through that voice, if you are capable of hearing those words, that's why sometimes the poets hear those voices, the small voices, which we may call it as intuition, which may give different names. And Ghalib Sharire Khama, the sound, like when you take the pen and put it on the paper, the movement of the pen creates a sound. Sharire Khama, that's the sound. Navai Sharos is that of the angel who speaks through me. The small voice is speaking. I am writing it down. So it is said that sometimes we have heard saying that I have to be in the mood. A Zen master has put it into a beautiful way. He was a carpenter by profession. So one day the king invited him and asked him that he wants him to make a particular chair. So he asked, the king inquired, how long will it take the chair to be made? The master said, first of all, I have to go to the forest and see which of the trees is ready to be converted into the chair. What a strange stupidity is this, you may wonder. But those who understand the subtle intricacies of this, they will realize that there are moments when the thoughts flow fluently. Other times, you are making an effort and it is not flowing. But the moment the ocean lends its quality to the drop, that connection is never severed. That connection is never severed then. The moment you start speaking, the moment a particular question is asked, you ask a sheikh, you ask a master, anything. Is this, he has opened the gates of that message to flow in. That connection is never severed. But in order to put that on paper, you need a paper and a pen, or if you are directly typing it, then you have to open your laptop or the device and you start writing it and the flow continues. Then if the connection is not complete, all of a sudden it stops. But once that process has become part of you, that connection is never severed. It continues until the moment comes when the life when the time that has been allocated to you or you have chosen, it's actually the master chooses the time of his dissolution. Vivekananda mentioned 5 or 6 years before, he said, I am going to live 5 or 6 years more. Because after enlightenment, it happens, the matter does not expand. What expands is that which resides within that physical space. You built a house, you built the rooms. This is matter. It cannot expand. Your room space will not expand. The room space will start getting smaller and smaller. When the room is finished, you had a certain amount of accessories, equipments to place into, but as the passage goes on, the life continues, you add new equipments, new accessories to your room, the space gets narrow and narrow. And then a moment comes in that the room cannot expand. The room cannot expand, which is physical, which is matter. In the same way, your body cannot expand. It has its limitations. But that which resides within the body becomes so enlarged that it cannot stay within. Your house, you will realize the simple examples gives you a tremendous opportunity. Why did you change your house? You already had a house, but you wanted a bigger space, a larger space, more facilities. So you change your residence, because that which is going to reside within is expanding, but that which is residing within that matter, within that space, cannot expand. So you change from one residence to another. The soul is the one that resides in this physical body, this matter, composed of the matter, the bones, the flesh, the blood, and all that. It resides in that. That cannot change. The capacity of your bones cannot expand. The flesh, nothing can do. So the only thing is this, just as you change the house, you change your clothes, you put on more weight, that same clothes that you had appreciated at the time of your wedding no more fit you. You need to buy another outfit and you do not lament over it. In the same way, when in the process of growth, the inner self, the being, the soul expands and it reaches beyond the horizon of the physical matter, it must discard it. So, who is going to decide that? You are living in the house. You are the one who is residing within that narrow space, encompassed by the matter. You are the one who has to decide that the space of this house is no more suitable for me and my family to live in. I need to change this residence to a bigger space. you buy, you construct another space. You are to decide. It is the soul that decides that I cannot stay in this dilapidated, in this congested space. Why did you change your resistance? Residence? Because it was a smaller space, the number of rooms were smaller, the space within the rooms have become narrow. That which is residing, the children are growing. You need to provide better facilities to them. A decision is made to change the residence. The soul decides that I am going to change the residence. And that decision, the moment it is taken. So it is, I have given you a very simple analogy to understand how does a master make a decision. You say, oh wow, the master made a decision. You did not lament when you made a decision to buy a new house. Everyone around was happy. But here something, one more factor is added to it. So then ocean lends its magnanimity to it and you start living with that understanding, with that cosmic understanding. This is life beyond enlightenment. This is life beyond enlightenment. So when Kabir called Kamal and he said, it is the last moments, I must vanish. But before that happens, you must add these lines to the existing one. The drop, the ocean has merged into the ocean. When I wrote those, when the drop has merged into the ocean, that was my first impression. And this is my last impression in uttering these words. Kabir closed his eyes. But both impressions, both expressions are beautiful. In the beginning, of course, you will see the dewdrop is disappearing in the ocean. But finally, you will realize the ocean has disappeared into the dewdrop. It is the individual decision whether to stay after that or not. Kabir decided not to stay after that. But there is life beyond enlightenment as well. The masters continue, depending on the work that they have to do in the process of the transformation of human consciousness, what is his role? Whatever is there, for instance, there are people who are in the corporate business. They work from their office, they work from their, away from the office, from their homes as well. So the masters are those corporate employees of the existence. They work both from any space that they are in. Even if they are traveling in the plane, they can use that space to communicate from there as well. They are in transit in another airport or in another city, from there they can continue their work. This is how the work of the masters continue. Only this much for this morning until tomorrow. Take care and do have a pleasant day.